I am honored today to introduce this year's Northwestern University Commencement Speaker. In the spring of 2004, Illinois Congresswoman Jan Schakowsky went to the White House wearing an Obama button. The button caught the attention of President Bush, who told her he had never heard of Obama. She replied simply, "You will." She was right, and it didn't take long. A few months later, Barack Obama's electrifying keynote address at the Democratic National Convention immediately made him a national figure. Born to a father from Kenya and a mother from Kansas, Barack Obama was raised in Hawaii and Indonesia and graduated from Columbia University and Harvard Law School, where he was the first black editor of the Harvard Law Review. Before entering politics, he worked in Chicago as a community organizer and civil rights attorney and taught law at the University of Chicago. In 1996, he was elected to the Illinois Senate, where he worked with lawmakers on both sides of the aisle for reforms in criminal justice, tax policy, and early childhood education. As a U.S. Senate candidate in 2004, State Senator Obama was a distinct underdog. His Democratic primary opponents included a state office holder supported by the party establishment and a millionaire willing to spend whatever it took to win. Yet, Barack Obama not only won the seven-candidate race, he won by an outright majority. And he went on to win the general election with 70% of the vote. As a new senator, he has already been selected as his party spokesman on political ethics reform. I am proud to present a distinguished public servant and an inspiration to Americans of all races and political persuasions, Senator Barack Obama.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Oh, thank you. Congratulations to the class of 2006. We are extraordinarily proud of you. Congratulations to the parents, the uncles, the aunts, the cousins, the friends who helped them all get here in one piece. John, thank you so much for that generous introduction. President Bynum, Board of Trustees, faculty, parents, family, and friends. I am extremely honored to be a part of this wonderful celebration. You know, a few months ago, I came across an article in your student newspaper by Elaine Mayer. Is Elaine here? There she is. Wave, Elaine. There she is. Glad to see you made it to graduation. So Elaine writes this article entitled, "Challenge Us, Senator Obama." And I thought this seemed like a fair request. So I kept reading, and I noticed that Elaine had set out a few expectations for this speech. According to the article, I'm supposed to be inspirational, but not contrived. I'm supposed to be hopeful, but not cheesy. I should be political, but not too political. I should be better than John McCain, but not so good that I have to spend an entire day with Jerry Falwell. To further illustrate what she was looking for, Elaine then very kindly quoted at length from the commencement address that I had delivered at Knox College in Galesburg last year, which then completely ruined my plan to recycle that speech for this year. Left with no speech and a lot of pressure, I then turned to who else but Elaine for help. And what she wrote next is precisely what I'd like to talk to all of you about today. Elaine said, and I quote, "When people say they don't want to hear about politics in a commencement address, they are in part speaking of not wanting to hear about the outside world and its problems. We students have been insulated enough for the past 4 years that it shouldn't hurt us to be challenged for 30 minutes, actually 25, especially on a day that marks our commencement into the, quote, real world." That struck me as an important statement, and it called to mind a passage from Scripture that some of you may be familiar with. In Corinthians chapter 13, verse 11, it reads as follows. "When I was a child, I spoke as a child, I felt as a child, I thought as a child. But now that I have become a man, I have put away childish things. Now that I have become a man or a woman, I have put away childish things." I bring this up because there is an assumption in rites of passage like this one that growing up is just a function of age, that becoming an adult is an inevitable and natural progression. But in fact, I know a whole lot of 30-year-olds and 40-year-olds and 50-year-olds and even some 60-year-olds who are not yet full grown. And if you talk to my wife, she'll tell you that there are times where I do not put aside childish things, when I continue to struggle to rise above the selfish or the petty or the small. So even today, as a United States Senator, I have to remind myself at times of certain lessons from my youth, lessons about growing up and being true to my values and ideals. The first lesson came during my first year in college. I was a little younger than all of you. Back then, I had a tendency, in my mother's words, to be a little casual about my future. I rebelled, angry in a way that many young people in general, and many young black men in particular, are angry, thinking that responsibility and hard work were old-fashioned conventions that didn't apply to me. I partied a little too much, I confess. I studied just enough to get by. And once, after a particularly long evening of debauchery, we had spilled a little too much beer, broken a few too many bottles, trashed a little too much of the dorm room. And the next day, the mess was so bad that one of the cleaning ladies came in and saw it, and she began to tear up. And a girlfriend of mine heard about this, and she said to me, "That woman could have been my grandmother, Barack. She spent her days cleaning up after somebody else's mess. That woman could have been my grandmother." Which drove home the first lesson that all of us have to go through in growing up, and that is that the world does not revolve around you. You know, there's a lot of talk in this country about the federal deficit. And I think it's important for us to talk about that, but I think we should talk more about another deficit, what I call the empathy deficit, the ability to put ourselves in somebody else's shoes, to see the world through those who are different from us, the child who's hungry, the laid-off steel worker, the immigrant woman who's cleaning up your dorm room. As you go on in life, cultivating this quality of empathy actually becomes harder, not easier. There's no community service requirement in the real world. No one is forcing you to care. You'll be free to live in neighborhoods with people who are exactly like yourself, went to the same schools. You can send your children to the same schools, and you can narrow your concerns to what's going on in your own immediate circle. Not only that, but we live in a culture that discourages empathy, a culture that all too often tells us that our principal goal in life is to be rich, thin, young, famous, safe, and entertained. A culture where those in power all too often encourage our most selfish impulses. So there will be those who will tell you that the Americans who sleep in the streets and beg for food got there because they're all lazy and weak in spirit. That the inner city children who are trapped in dilapidated schools can't learn and won't learn, and so we should give up on them entirely. That the innocent people being slaughtered and expelled from their homes on the other side of the globe are somebody else's problem to care for. I hope you don't listen to this. I hope you choose to broaden and not contract the ambit of your concern. Not because you have an obligation to those who are less fortunate, although you do have that obligation. Not just because you have a debt to pay for those who helped to get you where you are, although I do think you have that debt, but rather because you have an obligation to yourself. Because what I've found in my life is that my individual salvation depends on our collective salvation. Because it's only when you hitch your wagon to something larger than yourself that you'll realize your true potential, that you'll become full grown. Which brings me to a second lesson I learned, this one after college, when I had this crazy idea that I wanted to be a community organizer and work in low-income neighborhoods. I didn't exactly know what a community organizer was, but I decided that's what I wanted to be. And my mother and grandparents thought I should go to law school. My friends were applying for jobs on Wall Street. But I went ahead and I wrote letters to every organization in the country that I could think of. And finally, this small group of churches on the south side of Chicago wrote back, and they gave me a job organizing neighborhoods that had been devastated by the steel plant closings that were occurring in the early 80s. Now, the churches didn't have much money, so they offered me a grand sum of $12,000 a year plus $1,000 for car expenses. And I got ready to move to Chicago, a place where I'd never been and didn't know a living soul. Even the people who didn't know me very well expressed skepticism. I remember having a conversation with an older man before I arrived in Chicago. I told him about my plans, and he looked at me and said, "Let me tell you something." He said, "You look like a nice, clean-cut young man. You've got a nice voice, so let me give you a piece of advice. Forget this community organizing business. You can't change the world, and people won't appreciate you trying. What you should do is go into television broadcasting. I am telling you that you've got a future there." Now, I could have taken my mother's advice. I could have taken my grandparents' advice. I could have followed the path that my friends were traveling. And objectively speaking, that TV thing might have made some sense. But I knew there was something in me that wanted to try for something else. So the second lesson is this: challenge yourself. Test yourself. Take some risks in your life. This may be difficult for all of you because one of the things about graduating from Northwestern is that you can now punch your own ticket. You can take your diploma and walk off this stage and go chasing after the big house and the large salary and the nice suits and all the wonderful things that our money culture says that you should buy. I hope you don't stop there. And focusing your life solely on making a buck is useful. It helps you raise a family, but it displays a certain poverty of ambition. It asks too little. I suspect it may leave you unfulfilled. You know, I often think about the young Americans, teenagers, and college kids about your age from all over the country watching the civil rights movement unfold before them on their television sets back in the early 60s. And I imagine that they would have seen the marchers and heard the speeches, but they also probably saw the dogs and the fire hoses and the tear gas or the footage of innocent people being beaten within an inch of their lives. Or perhaps they heard the news of four little girls who one Sunday morning died while in Sunday school. Instinctively, these young people would have known that it was safer and smarter to stay at home, to watch that movement from afar. But they also understood that those people in Georgia and Mississippi and Alabama were their brothers and sisters, that what was happening was wrong, and that they had an obligation to try to help make it right. So when the buses pulled up for the Freedom Rides going south, they got on. They took a risk, and they changed the world. So don't let people just talk you into doing the safe thing all the time. Listen to what's inside of you and decide what it is that you care about so much that you are willing to risk everything for it. The third lesson, what I learned once I got into Chicago. I had spent weeks now organizing our very first community meeting around the issue of gang violence. We invited the police, we made phone calls, went to churches, we passed out flyers. Now, I had been warned that the turf battles and politics in Chicago could be rough, but I ignored them, confident that I knew what I was doing. So the night of the meeting, we arranged rows and rows of chairs in anticipation of a big crowd. And we waited. And we waited. And finally, a group of older people walked into the hall, and they sat down. And this little old lady raised her hand, and she asked, "When's the bingo game starting?" 13 people showed up that night. The police commander never showed up. The meeting was a complete disaster. And later, the volunteers that I was working with told me that they were quitting. They had been at this for quite some time, and they had nothing to show for it, they said. And I was tired, too. But at that point, I looked outside, and I saw some young boys playing in a vacant lot across the street, tossing stones at boarded-up apartment buildings. And I turned to the volunteers, and I asked them, "Before you quit, I want to ask all of us a question. What's going to happen to these boys? Who will fight for them if not us? Who will give them a fair shot if we leave?" In that moment, I think we were all reminded of a third lesson of being full grown, and that is that sometimes you just have to persevere. You know, making your mark in the world is hard. If it were easy, everybody would do it. But it's not. It takes patience. It takes commitment, and it comes with plenty of failure along the way. So the real test is not whether you avoid this failure, because you won't. It's whether you let it harden and shame you into inaction, or whether you learn from it, whether you choose to persevere. You know, after my little speech that day, one by one, the volunteers decided not to quit. And we went back into those neighborhoods, and we kept at it, sustaining ourselves with small victories. And over time, a community changed. And lo and behold, so had we. Cultivating empathy, challenging yourself, persevering in the face of adversity. These are qualities that I found important in my own life. But here's the interesting thing. What's true for individuals can also be true for nations. For what America needs right now, more than ever, is a sense of purpose that guides us through the challenges that lie ahead, a maturity that we seem to have lost somewhere along the way, a willingness to engage in a sober adult conversation about our future. When we measure the greatness of our nation by how far the stock market rises or falls, instead of how many opportunities we've opened up for all of America's children, I would argue we're displaying a preference for the childish. When we believe that force is the only way to accomplish our ends in the world, when our leaders exaggerate or fudge the truth, we haven't set aside childish things. When we run our budget into red ink for things that we want instead of things that we need, we're indicating that we're not yet full grown. Now, for a brief moment, there was hope that this kind of public life, this kind of politics, had come to an end. After 9/11, there was a sense of unity born from the rubble of those buildings. Young people signing up to serve, political leaders of both parties working together, people asking new questions in a world that was hungry for answers. But at some point, it seems like we began to drift. Republicans and Democrats alike, we went back to procrastinating about problems that we had to face now. We sent young Americans to fight a war without asking any of us back home to sacrifice our time or their tax cuts. We argued about the inconsequential. We caricature our opponents to score cheap political points. Our media returned to covering the sensational and feeding our ever-shortening attention span. And in the meantime, our problems are left to fester. And we have a global economy that's forcing us to compete like never before. In today's world, a job can travel anywhere. There's an internet connection and a worker who's smart and skilled. And if China and India keep educating their kids better and longer than we are, that's where the jobs will go. Now, we can meet this challenge if we fix our schools, if we make college affordable, if we retrain our workers, if we invest more in research and technology. We know what needs to be done. What's lacking is the political will. We have a health care crisis in this country that's left 46 million Americans uninsured, that's left millions unable to deal with rising co-payments, that's left businesses near bankruptcy. We can meet this challenge if we modernize our health care system, if we improve quality, if we pool our resources to bargain for affordable insurance. What's been lacking is the political will. We have an energy crisis that's keeping gas prices high, destroying our climate, forcing us to send billions of dollars to the very countries who want to cause us harm. We can meet this challenge if we harness alternative fuels and build cars that go further on a tank of gas and finally invest in mass transit, but we need to find the will to make it happen. We need new strategies to fight the war on terror. In a world where terrorists can hide and blend into any city on any country in the planet, we can't just believe, as Bill Clinton characterized, that we can kill or jail every single one of our enemies. We can meet this challenge if we realize that this isn't just a battle of armies, but also a battle of ideas. If we rebuild our institutions and strengthen our alliances, as Truman and Acheson and Keenan and Marshall did after World War II, if we bring hope to those pockets of desperation where jihad is a better bet than a job. But what's lacking is the political will. Each and every one of these challenges call for an America that's more purposeful, that's more grown up than the America that we have today. An America that reflects the lessons that have helped so many of its people mature in their own lives. An America that's not just about each of us, but about all of us. An America that takes great risks in the face of greater odds. An America that, above all, perseveres. You know, over 150 classes have sat where you sit today. Some in good times, others in bad. Some were years that just rolled into the next, and other would mark a turning point in our nation. The class of 1860 would find their country torn apart by civil war in less than a year. Many of them would listen to their president, tell them that a house divided cannot stand, and they would answer the call to save a union and free a people. The class of 1932 would look out at a nation mired in depression, a nation ill-fed, ill-clothed, and ill-housed. They would hear a man who could not lift himself up from his wheelchair and yet was able to lift a nation up by telling us that it was only fear itself standing in our way. And that class would answer the call to conquer the fear. The class of 1960 would find themselves at the beginning of a decade where social and racial strife threatened to tear apart the very fabric of a nation. They would hear a young president urge them to ask what they could do for their country, and they would answer the call to sit at lunch counters and take those freedom rides. They would march for justice and live for equality. They would fight in war, and they would speak out against a war, and they would work to prevent the need for war. And now it's 2006, and here you sit, facing challenges as great as any in the past, some that we cannot even imagine yet. And the choice is yours. Will the years pass with barely a whisper from your generation? Or will we look back on this time as a moment where all of you took a stand and changed the world? Time will tell. You will be tested by the challenges of this new century, and at times you will fail. But know that you have it within your power to try. The generations who've come before you faced some of these same fears and uncertainties in their own time. And that if we're willing to shoulder each other's burdens and take great risks and persevere through great trials, America can continue on its magnificent journey towards that distant horizon and a better day. I expect a lot out of you, class of 2006. Congratulations on your graduation, and Elaine, I hope I did okay. Thank you very much.